Evolution in alien biospheres elsewhere in the universe will likely result in advanced animal-like beings, just like on Earth. And all animal life as we know it starts out as a clump of cells, both developmentally and evolutionarily. But it's one thing to be composed of complex cells organized into tissues, another thing is to have the sophisticated body architecture of a modern, highly evolved vertebrate or arthropod. Such highly convoluted creature designs are the result of a well-coordinated cascade of biomolecular patterns expressed during the embryonic development from a single cell. So how did single cells become everything from tiny insects to majestic whales? And what are some universal guiding principles for the evolution of animals that we may also expect to apply elsewhere in the universe? Let's find out. For any exoplanet similar enough to Earth, several universal principles will naturally be imposed on the living systems evolving in its biosphere. Obviously, there's the axiom of up and down, enforced by the vector of gravity combined with the main source of light and warmth provided by its host star from above. Gravity is suspended to some degree underwater, where life presumably will originate. And any pelagic microbes will quickly learn to orient themselves towards the sun and away from the cold depths of the ocean, unless they can live off the organic debris raining down all the time or other sources. In shallow waters, benthic life will thrive, bathing in sunlight and tepid waters. In the previous video, we already arrived at the nested modular design of a basic multicellular creature, sporting an outer cell layer around a fluidic matrix with other cells mixed in. At first, such a being doesn't need any definite sites and can just get cues from its surroundings for finding out what's up and what's down. In order to stay buoyant and be able to seek more favorable conditions, the external cells must first of all have some kind of propulsion system. Earth's animalian cells derive from protists known as coanoflagellates, equipped with a so-called flagellum, used for swimming and also catching food, with the help of a surrounding collar. So the earliest animals may have simply been a globular collective of motorized cells bouncing about, very much like the coanoflagellate Spherica volvax over here. For a collective like this, sharing resources can be very beneficial, as well as communication. Special proteins or mineral ions can be used to spread intercellular signals around, establishing some basic forms of coordination. It's when an entity like that starts interacting with the substrate that things truly become interesting. Our free-swimming cell aggregate may start adopting a sessile lifestyle, anchoring itself wherever food is plenty, and its offspring will disperse again to find new areas to settle. A primal sense of direction, first further away from their birthplace and then towards the bottom, would be a very handy addition. Alternatively, our protoanimal may just want to be crawling about looking for food, with the downside that then there will be a downside, literally. At any given moment, only one side will be in contact with the substrate where the food is. So in both cases, our cell collective may want to establish two distinct sides, or in other words, polarity. When swimming, the front side could lead the way with the opposite side doing the heavy lifting. When settling, the bottom side could be the attachment base, while the top side collects food. When crawling, however, the bottom would be the side collecting food from the substrate instead. The early ancestors of animals may have been very much like these simple life forms, if not exactly so, and correspond to sponge larvae, sponges, and placozoans, respectively. So polarity is foundational. If you want to design animal creatures from the ground up that are to amount to anything, you have to be mindful of body axes. From life on Earth, we know of several fundamental mechanisms establishing the primary orientation of the developing embryo and subsequent body regions. For starters, there is cell fate specification based on the sequence of early cell divisions, eventually branching into whole groups of cells forming different sections of the body. The developing egg sac is also affected by genetic products generated by its parent. Maternal effects imbue the embryo with polarity from very early on by kicking off the production of special signal molecules in one particular end of the body. These so-called morphogens are typically special regulator proteins able to turn genes on or off. So, with polarity thus enabled, how could an evolving creature use this to their advantage? As said, both free-living and sessile animals could dedicate one particular side to gathering food. Subsequently, folding this side inwards would increase surface area and enable the ingestion of food particles for further digestion and distribution throughout the body. We then have a primordial gut, and constricting its entrance would form a primordial mouth. This is the fundamental polarity for any creature remotely resembling an animal and will result in a so-called oral end, where the mouth is located, and an opposite aboral end. On Earth, we can find this primal pattern in basically all animals, be it sponges, placozoans, cnidarians, ctenophores, or bilaterians. The most fundamental animal body axis is thus the oral-aboral axis, and this will probably be a universal principle for animaloid beings throughout the universe. Therefore, any animaloids will probably commonly have what corresponds to an endoderm, correlating with the invaginated primordial gut, and an ectoderm, correlating with the outer layer. These two primary tissue layers can then form additional folds inwards or outwards to differentiate even further into internal organs or external body parts. So far, we've covered several basic ways that can be used to control bodily differentiation. In more complex animals, the most powerful and versatile mechanism is the one based on morphogens, and it's fair to assume similar systems will be universal for most animaloid life. As morphogens diffuse to adjacent areas, they're slowly broken down again, resulting in their concentration levels following a gradually declining gradient. The neat thing with morphogen gradients is that they can provide a kind of coordinate system. From the max value at the source, there will be a smooth transition to lower levels at the end. Concentration levels can then provide positional information to the cells along the axis, or in other words, a coordinate. The presence of certain threshold levels of morphogens can unlock or suppress specific genes leading to different cell types and behaviors like growth or cell death. A single threshold creates a binary on-off condition, and multiple threshold levels could each lead to different outcomes. A ternary threshold pattern, for example, can be visualized as a French flag with the red end having the highest concentration and the blue end approaching zero. Levels in the red zone could mark down the oral end, prompting the formation of a mouth with tentacles, for instance. The tissues in the white zone with medium morphogen levels could just elongate into a tube, and the lowest levels in the blue zone could induce the cells there to form a peduncle. The resulting body plan would then follow the pattern of a polyp-like creature. So how about more complex patterns? Those can actually be accomplished very easily with additional morphogen gradients. For instance, by combining two morphogen sources set at an angle, many different areas could be specified depending on the number of thresholds. And when morphogens are enabled to interact with each other, magic starts to happen. The gradients will then behave like sets of waveforms that can stabilize into a standing wave, creating a virtual landscape adorned with various peaks, crests, and valleys. Minor tweaks of initial conditions can lead to a myriad of different forms and arrangements. None other than the father of modern computing himself, Alan Turing already recognized this principle. In a 1952 paper, he formulated what has become known as the Reaction-Diffusion Model, a simple mathematical description of many complex patterns seen in nature. Developmental biologists have since discovered that Turing's formulas fit perfectly with animal coloration patterns that can morph from spots into stripes, labyrinths, spirals, and more. In theory, these chemical dynamics are what give the tiger its stripes and the leopard its spots. And they even explain the irregular spacing of macrostructures like hairs and skin denticles. Now, it's important to remember that morphogens are like switches. They don't do anything in themselves other than turning certain genes on or off. The genetic states of the cells exposed to the morphogen determines how they respond. One thing is turning on a single gene, producing a pigment. Another thing is starting a cascade of reactions, leading to the emergence of major structures like scales or even whole body parts. For instance, let's take a look at the formation of an appendage like a tentacle. A localized morphogen hotspot could specify the tip with a gradient diffusing in all directions. Medium levels around the edges could incite the cells there to multiply and grow in a way that pushes the tip or apex outwards. Each outfolding essentially becomes a subset of the body with its very own polarity and gradients. Such polarities create a proximal distal axis with proximal at the base and distal being the apex. It's clear that by adding more gradients, we can start to differentiate polarity itself. And juxtaposing another polarity to the oral-aboral axis is also what's needed for bilateral symmetry. This will establish a secondary body axis known as the anterior-posterior axis. The anterior end is typically the leading edge of a bilateral creature, with the posterior end trailing behind. So how are more complex divisions imposed onto the body axis thus obtained? In Earth's bilaterians, scientists have discovered an entire family of morphogens responsible for overall body layouts, and the genes producing these are called Hox genes. Once primary polarities of a developing embryo are established, a cascade of diffusion reactions creates a whole suite of overlapping morphogen patterns straddling the length of the body. When combined, these set up the identity of each body region and any further subdivisions. Highly evolved bilaterians like arthropods have 10 Hox genes, and vertebrates can have up to 39. Simpler and more primitive animals like nematodes only have a few of them, and radial animals like cnidarians were long assumed to lack the secondary polarity that bilaterians possess. A recent discovery, however, has turned this notion upside down, or rather, on its side. As it turns out, the same Hox genes as in bilaterians subdivide the body of cnidarians into equal but radially arranged segments. Each segment sports an oral tentacle externally and septate divisions internally. So even the simple head of a sea anemone has fundamentally the same kind of seriation or segmentation as the complex body of highly evolved bilaterians like vertebrates and arthropods. Now, science has already made great strides uncovering life's evolutionary developmental biology, or Evo-Devo, but a lot of details are still being worked out for different kinds of animals. So what can we take away from all of this? Speculative animals are often created by plugging body parts onto a generic body frame. So-called evolution simulators like Spore are an infamous example of this process that is more like playing with a Mr. Potato Head toy than actually evolving an integral creature. A more holistic approach is perceiving the entire body as a single entity, subdivided and branching out into different subsets, lending a more profound realism to the speculative fauna. evolution really is just a long chain of increasingly convoluted tweaks of simple biomolecular mechanisms and patterns. The emergence of a complex body plan is the result of an incremental number of morphogen gradients working onto cell lineages and tissue folds. Emerging polarities can be subdivided further and nested into ever more refined structures. Understanding this process and how it works for real-life creatures will also give us a better idea of what developments are likely to happen again elsewhere in the universe. The following episodes, we're going to apply what we've learned so far and take a closer look at different animal body plans as evolved on Earth. Each episode, we'll investigate what it takes to arrive at a certain body plan and how we can tweak this process to arrive at different outcomes. First up are the arthropods. What are the ingredients of the arthropod body plan, and how do you cook one up by applying the heat of natural selection? How may we create our own alternate arthropods, and are there ways to evolve these into larger and more impressive creatures? Subscribe and hit the bell icon to be among the first to find out. And please do leave a comment on your way out. For now, cheers and bye-bye.